Let's go to the message today, which is walking in spiritual authority. Now, I've done many messages on spiritual authority through the years. Never one like this one, I'll assure you. There are certain things that are God's responsibility, and certain things that are our responsibility, and God will never violate those lines. There are certain things that are God's responsibility, and certain things that are our responsibility, and God will never violate those lines. For example, in James 4:7, submit therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Those aren't just words filling up the paper here. When God says something, He means it. So when God says resist the devil, it's mine and your responsibility to resist the devil. Right. Amen. The Lord is not going to step in, and He will not do it for you. You and I have to resist the devil. Amen. As I go to the next statement, I want you to keep it in context of what I'm talking about, resisting the devil and taking your stands against the evil in this world. So the statement that we can't do anything with Adam is absolutely true. If you're not born again, but if you're born again, you're not without him.
That's right.
So don't you tell God you can't resist temptation when the Lord of glory himself dwells within you, and the scripture testifies in Philippians 4:13, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. He has saved you, he's redeemed you, justified you, and sanctified you. And he's also made you responsible for exercising the spiritual authority delegated to you by the Lord Jesus himself. And that authority is meant to impact every area of our lives. It means for us to live in victory. It's absolutely essential to understand spiritual authority if you're going to have any kind of victory in your life. And to pray effectively, it is absolutely essential to understand our spiritual authority. Luke 10:19. Look, I've given you authority over all the power of the enemy, and you can walk among snakes and scorpions and crush them. Nothing will injure you. This is talking about demonic forces. Paul spelled it out very clearly in his letter to Ephesians, Ephesians 1. I pray that your hearts will be flooded with light so that you can understand the confident hope he has given to those he called, his holy people who are his rich and glorious inheritance. I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe him. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. Now, he is far above any ruler or authority or power or leader or anything else, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. God has put all things under the authority of Christ and has made him head over all things for the benefit of the church. And the church is his body. It is made full and complete by Christ and fills all things everywhere with himself. Paul prays that we would apprehend what we already have.
Right.
And spiritual authority that has been delegated by Jesus to us. The devil is after your faith.
Amen.
And you need to write that on the tablet of your heart. He's after your faith to throw you so that you will get angry at God or whatever, anything to make you stop praying. Everything that in this world that comes after your faith. But our faith and our testimony, we always can conquer.
Amen.
Because God will always give us, if we hold on to our faith, give us the testimony that will wipe the devil out, I promise you. And you and I will always end up victorious if we just hold on to it. Remember that temptation is not a sin. It's an invitation to sin. Just decline the invitation is what we're talking about here. We forget that we have the sinless one living inside of us. Which means if he's the sinless one, he's living inside of us, it means that you and I can live sinless.
Right.
Now, we have a hard time doing that because we don't believe that we can. And that's what Satan loves to do. But sin is foreign to the Lord. And so it should be foreign to us.
Amen.
If we allow him to have authority in our life. God wants us to walk in kingdom authority. That's what kings and priests do. But for many of us, we don't clearly comprehend what we do have, and we don't believe we actually have it. So let me give you a definition here about kingdom authority that I think will be very meaningful to you. Kingdom authority is the divinely authorized right and responsibility delegated to believers to act on God's behalf in spiritually ruling over his creation under the lordship of Jesus Christ. Paul's prayer in Ephesians is that we should see what we don't see.
Amen.
So that we can live at the supernatural level Jesus has made available to us.
Amen.
Which would move us automatically to a higher plane of living. In verse 3 of Ephesians 1, Paul declared that we already have all of the spiritual blessings we need. We're not waiting to get them. We did a message on that. We talked about the 10 blessings. Matter of fact, we printed it out and gave it to you. And they are that he chose you, he made you holy and righteous, he predetermined you to become like his son, he adopted you, accepted you, redeemed you, forgave you, revealed his mystery to you, gave you an inheritance, and sealed you with the Holy Spirit. But it's one thing to know what you are, and it's an entirely different thing to walk in it.
Come on.
The Bible teaches that I am complete in Jesus.
Right.
Paul prays that we would see or recognize the incredible greatness of God's power for us who will believe him. In other words, the Lord doesn't want us to wait until we get to heaven to see how mighty and powerful our God is.
Amen.
He wants us to be enlightened now, in this life and at this time. There's more of him that he wants us to experience, and God wants to show off his power to us.
Amen.
What kind of power am I talking about? The kind that changes things. God wants you, he wants me to see that he can change anything and everything. Nothing is impossible with him. Nothing is too hard for him. Nothing is ignored by him. And nothing is confusing to him. And nothing is beyond him. He is Lord of all. When Jesus ascended into heaven, the Father seated him in heavenly places. When Jesus sat down, in other words, his work was complete on my behalf and complete on your behalf. Now he watches and he prays for you and for me that we will walk out everything that he has already provided for us.
Amen.
We're not trying to get things. We have things. Everything that God has for us. He not only sat down, he was given all authority. So therefore he rules from the throne on which he was seated because he is Lord.
Amen.
Since he has all authority, that means he cannot be overruled. Our Lord Jesus rules over everything in the universe.
Amen.
Listen carefully. Because he overrules, He can't be overruled. So when the enemy attempts to overrule what Jesus is doing in your life, the Lord has veto power. Now, for those of you who don't understand veto power, let me tell you what it is. He can turn it down. He can overrule. He can throw it out. He can prohibit it. He can disallow it. He can ban it, block it. He can stop it, nullify it, kill it, squash it. Because he is Lord. It's his veto power over the enemy that is translated to you as conviction when you're about to be disobedient. When Jesus objects to a decision you're about to make, the conviction of the Holy Spirit that you experience is the Lord's veto on your pending decision.
Wow.
He's trying to rule you and shake you and speak to you and say, don't do that. Don't go that way. Why does Jesus have veto power? Because he's Lord above all lords and King above all kings. No one is higher and no one is stronger than he is. The devil lied when he said to Jesus, why would the devil lie? He's a liar. Everything he says is a lie. Look at Matthew 4, 8 through 9. Again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me. Now, I want you to pay attention. We've heard all kind of teachings. We've done them and we've heard them. All the kingdoms of the world and their glory belong to the King of Kings, not to Satan, who pretended to have authority over them. Back in the garden, the only kind of authority that Satan really gained at that point was over the Garden of Eden. Amen. There wasn't any more kingdoms available.
That's right.
When he showed Jesus up on the Mount of Temptation, we're talking about now in the New Testament, there's a lot of kingdoms. He was a total liar. He didn't own any of that, or didn't have any of that. Now, that's the devil's consistent deception. He believes that he has authority, but he doesn't have any. Get it down inside of you. He does not have any authority unless you give it to him. No authority. Because of the precious blood of Jesus shed on the cross, for our salvation, our sanctification, and our glorification. Now, I went through slowly that Matthew 4, 8 through 9, because again, it was an eye-opening experience for me when the Lord began to talk to me about that yesterday, this morning, continued about that, and set me straight. Our responsibility is to stop believing the liar. John wrote in 1 John 3:8, the one who practices sin is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. The Son of God appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. Now, let me point out something here because people get things confused. Jesus did not destroy the devil. He destroyed the works of the devil. And yet we act as if the Satan is destroyed. He is not destroyed. But his works have been destroyed. And we have power over his works, meaning anything he tries to do. You have more than enough power residing within you to live triumphant with the very power of God Almighty, which Jesus delegated to us. Jesus has the power. He then said, here, have the power. He gave it to us. We are not wimps. He gave us the power.
Healing belongs to you. Sandra Kennedy's package, I Sent My Word and Healed Them, includes the CD entitled Words of Life for Healing, 58 minutes of healing scripture ministered by Sandra while original music plays in the background. The book, The Magnificent Word of the Lord, provides healing and other topics for scriptural prayer and explanations of how to apply scripture to your life to see a change in your circumstances. The DVD, I Sent My Word and Healed Them, is a message Sandra taught at Christ for the Nations. This message has gone all over the world and is an amazing presentation of the healing Christ has purchased for you. And as a point of contact to release your faith, 3 prayer cloths are included, imprinted with a special design given to Sandra through a vision, and have personally been anointed and prayed over by Sandra. Order the I Sent My Word and Healed Them package and release the healing power of God in your life today.
Now look with me at Ephesians 2. But God is so rich in mercy, and He loved us so much, that even though we were dead because of our sins, He gave us life when He raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved. That's a glory to God, the truth. For He raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ Jesus. Jesus isn't the only one who's seated in heaven. You have been spiritually located where He is in heaven, even though your physical self is down here on the earth. You need to listen. You have to remember that our Heavenly Father is the Father of spirits. We've talked so many times on spirit, soul, and body. That you are a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in a body. The body is the earthbound habitat. Yes. The spirit and soul are related to heaven. And the more you develop and grow your soul, then of course, the more you will walk out the Spirit of the Lord in your life, and the more you will understand letting the Spirit lead you. But it has to do with you developing your solace, your mind, your will, and your emotions. God does not do that for you. Amen. Now, if you are living by the Spirit, being led by the Spirit, if you're living by the Spirit of God, you're in your seat. If you're living your life by the flesh, by your emotions, and letting your flesh and your emotions rule your life, my life, if we do that, then of course we vacate our seat in heaven. It doesn't mean that the seat is removed from us. We vacate it. We leave it empty. You can't get heavenly directions to guide your life all the time if you just stay down here all the time. When it becomes real to you that you're seated with Christ in heavenly places, it will change the way you make decisions. The truth about your position in Jesus and the awareness of your location in heaven by His side will revolutionize how you think. Listen to this part or write it down. Our God-given spiritual authority is more powerful than political authority, civil authority, and any other kind of earthly authority. He is Lord. So how do we properly administer our spiritual authority? First and foremost, by being utterly and completely submitted to the Lordship of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible calls us ambassadors for Christ. And ambassadors, authority, is defined by the one who gave Him authority. Amen. Your spiritual authority does not qualify you to do whatever you want to do whenever you want to do it. It is delegated authority, which means you function in the boundaries that are set by the one who gave you the authority. Romans 14, 7 through 9 describes it for us. For we don't live for ourselves or die for ourselves. If we live, it's to honor the Lord. If we die, it's to honor the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Yes. Christ died and rose again for this very purpose, to be Lord both of the living and of the dead. Now, until you can truthfully say, I am not my own, I was bought with a price, the Lord can't trust you with a great deal of spiritual authority. Jesus wants to be Lord over every aspect of your life, and when He is, He can trust you to exercise your spiritual authority without defiling it with pride and with self-exaltation. Church, we can't heal a flea. But when you're faced with a life-threatening disease, I mean, whether it's yours, or you getting ready to pray over somebody with a life-threatening disease because you can't even heal a flea, then you have to understand that your spiritual authority will cause you to do two things, and you need to really know this. This is revelatory, I promise you. First, pray and ask the Lord whether or not you are the appointed vessel to deliver healing to that person. Now, I'm talking about someone we're talking about with a life-threatening disease. Everybody following me? When Peter was called upon to go where the body of Dorcas was, he didn't just walk in and flaunt his spiritual authority. Look at Acts 9. Peter asked them all to leave the room. Then he knelt and prayed. Turning to the body, he said, "Get up, Tabitha." And she opened her eyes when she saw Peter, and she sat up. I want you to see this because it's very important. Peter didn't rush in to lay hands on the dead body. First, he knelt and prayed. He asked the Lord what he should do. Was it the Lord's will that Tabitha be restored to life, or had she completed her race? All right, let's back up to destiny. Everybody has a destiny. We cannot extend that destiny. Only after praying to hear from the Lord did he turn to the body, and he said three words, "Tabitha, get up." Why could he do that? And she did. Why could she do that? Because he knelt and prayed and heard from the Lord. Amen. It is not her destiny nor time to go. Amen. He had a word from God. Are we listening? Yes. Now, this "if it be thy will" thing that I have preached for 40 years, we have used that, and most people have used that, as a lack of faith on the prayer's part. In other words, you know, if nothing happened, if it be thy will, heal them. People just say that, and I've said that's not a way to pray the prayer. We don't do that. We have got to learn to listen to the Lord. Destiny is so important to the Lord. The Lord, it is established by the Father, destiny. We need to hear very clearly, is this person run their destiny? If not, get up. Sometimes we pray for the sick and get frustrated with God because it appears that He didn't answer our prayers. Has it ever occurred to you, I'm quoting, has it ever occurred to you that perhaps that person has fulfilled his or her purpose and it was time for them to be received into the glorious presence of the Lord? We do make a lot of assumptions, don't we? So that statement does not in any way minimize the grace of healing provided by Jesus. But sometimes we make sweeping generalizations that we ought not to make. Healing is provided by Calvary. We should always pray for healing. Number two, recognize that spiritual authority is not something to play with. It's sacred, it's holy, and it's to be exercised in humility. Jesus did not hand down or bestow or bequeath spiritual authority to us in order to make us religious celebrities. Using our faith to exercise spiritual authority is for one purpose only, to glorify God. It's never about us, it's always about Him. Amen. To pray for someone and see them healed does not license you to brag about the fact that you're the one who prayed for them. Jesus alone is the healer, and only He deserves the glory.
Amen.
Jesus did not leave behind a powerless church when He ascended back to heaven. To the contrary, He imparted divine authority to those who follow Him, along with Holy Spirit power to accomplish great things for Him on this earth. I'm coming to a close, so I'm trying to put it all here so you understand. That divine power is a precious gift to be handled with humility and with integrity. The greatest place to exercise that authority is in prayer. You'll have more power, will accomplish more things in prayer than anything else that we can do. Spiritual warfare is real and far more powerful than discussions and debates. Learning to pray with divine authority is a lifelong journey. But with the help of the Holy Spirit, we can all learn to exercise our delegated authority just as Jesus would. Keeping in mind that compared to the greatest and most dramatic answer to prayer, the privilege of simply being with Jesus, sitting by His side in heavenly places, is by far the greatest. Amen. Jesus said, Luke 10:19-20, "Look, I've given you authority over all the powers of the enemy, and you can walk among snakes and scorpions and crush them. Nothing will injure you, but don't rejoice because evil spirits obey you.
Amen.
Rejoice because your names are registered in heaven." Reading from Esther. "Then Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, 'Do not imagine that you in the king's palace can escape any more than all the Jews. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise from the Jews from another place, and you and your father's house will perish. And who knows whether you have not attained royalty for such a time as this. You were born for such a time as this.'" I believe that's our calling here for what God has put in front of us and has called us to do.